first line.
The records themselves may seem rather dry, but they do deal with the vital question of the improvement of firearms among the powers who were contending for national influence and security in 19th century Europe. It was a time of concern, of extensive and informed public debate about the progress of the soldier's armory. Many citizens, including some of the most eminent, and among them numbers of volunteer riflemen, wanted to contribute to the national defense. They realized that the rifle was the key to the situation. What was needed in the rifle was a greater supply, greater range, greater durability, greater accuracy, greater firepower. And of all these requirements, by far the most important was greater supply. In the early part of the 19th century, manufacturing methods were simply not geared to the mass production of anything, let alone arms. The methods of arms manufacture, which today only survive in a small number of establishments, catering very much for the wealthy, were in the early 19th century the only methods of manufacture. Everything was made by hand, with only the limited assistance of a small number of very simple machines. This applied as much to the production of military arms as it did to the finest sporting guns or the cheaper run-of-the-mill weapons. When war threatened, all that the Ordnance Department could do was to go out to the trade and attempt to contract for adequate supplies. But highly skilled craftsmen were not to be enticed away from their lucrative business supplying the wealthy with firearms. The Ordnance Authorities had to rely upon those who were not skilled enough to earn more money elsewhere. Not surprisingly, they found it very difficult to procure a sufficient quantity of satisfactory arms. The same Napoleonic War which highlighted the Ordnance Department's difficulties also gave birth to this remarkable rifle. Remarkable in particular because it was actually made by hand to such precise standards that all its parts could be reliably replaced in the event of breakage or damage, even on the battlefield. Its maker was Henry Nock, a pioneer of the interchangeability of parts. The removal of the lock components could not be simpler. Even the inner lock plate is removed by simply pressing a catch. Nock not only gave his arms interchangeability of parts, he also completely avoided the use of screws. This is not the only screwless design of lock ever invented, but it is one of the very few, if not the only one, which really got into production. Curiously enough, one of the very few other arms likely to be encountered, which similarly avoids screws, is the Mauser automatic pistol of 1896 in its later variants. In Nock's locks, over 170 years old, the parts do prove to be properly interchangeable. The parts of the other lock fit easily and seat properly on the plate of the first. Nock's arms were so well liked by those who received them that new orders for more followed rapidly. But Nock could not find the extra gunsmiths of sufficient skill to increase his output and maintain quality. And Nock's were durable arms. One regiment had some for 32 years, refusing all replacements, normally due after 12 years. Nock had achieved interchangeability of parts, but he had not sought a means of mass production. In America, early in the century, Eli Whitney demonstrated that interchangeable arms could be mass-produced by means of machinery. The swing from hand-to-machine production gathered momentum in the States, and first really came to public notice in Britain through revolvers shown at the Great Exhibition bearing the name of Colt.
During the course of 1854, a purchasing mission was sent to the United States. The purpose was to buy equipment for the new Royal Small Arms Factory, and this machine was one of many bought there. The quality of the machine can be seen even in this specimen today. In fact, it was outstanding. And many of the machines continued in use well into this century. Some, as late as the 1920s, were still working, turning out SMLE rifle stocks. In fact, this machine originally was designed for inletting the stocks of pattern 53 rifle muskets, and it was one where, by rotation, successively the cutting stations were brought into position to deepen the cut. Well, it was very successful, so successful, in fact, that with the example of the Royal Small Arms Factory and the example, too, of the London Armoury Company's model factory, the Birmingham gun makers could no longer ignore the competition, and they organised themselves into the Birmingham Small Arms Company, BSA, a name better known today, perhaps for some of its other products, but they had to find something to do to get through the lean years when the demand for guns in the world was not high enough.
The Royal Small Arms Factory at Enfield was immensely successful. Production was strictly monitored with precise gauges for all parts, opening up the way to a far higher standard of quality control. For the first time, the British government could rest assured that at the outbreak of any war, it could rapidly obtain extra supplies of arms which were genuinely up to the standard of those made in peacetime. With the adoption of the idea of making all the parts of the arm interchangeable by means of machine manufacture, the problem of supply was very largely solved. But it was one thing to be able to produce arms in great quantity. It was quite another to decide what design to make them to. The government would probably not have decided to set up the Enfield factory unless they had been assured that a rifle both suitable for machine production and up to military requirements could be devised. The man upon whom they chose to lean was Joseph Whitworth. By arms collectors, Whitworth is above all remembered for his polygonal rifling, though it was not his invention and was never generally adopted in the army. Whitworth's real contributions were to the science of accurate measurements and the standardization of threads and gauges. His less direct but still crucial contribution was his general enthusiasm for the practicality of producing by machinery arms of the very highest standards demanded by the British Ordnance Authorities. Accuracy and standardization and high quality were the hallmarks of all Whitworth's work. So accurate and so well designed were his mass production tools that some of them are still in use today, over 100 years old. This Whitworth machine rest is still employed at Enfield for the test firing of barrels, a memorial to his genius. Though Whitworth's influence was decisive in the 1850s, it rapidly diminished thereafter. No memorials as tangible as his surviving machinery remain to all those who kept the government on the right lines, leading to adequate supplies of well-designed arms in the latter half of the 19th century. It was the Ordnance Select Committee who were required to advise the government on everything military, from the best mode of using balloons in warfare to the military applications of new forms of electric lighting. In the field of small arms, the committee was especially concerned with such fundamental requirements as the durability of the rifle. As calibers got progressively smaller, so the barrel wall got correspondingly thicker. This was obvious enough. The .577 Enfield pattern 53 would have been unacceptably heavy if the barrel had been any thicker. The Martini Henry of the late 1860s shows the reduction in caliber and consequent thickening of the barrel walls that proceeded through the century. In the case of the .303 Lee Metford, walls any thicker would only have increased accuracy to the detriment of other criteria. Barrels had to be thick enough not to get bent when a bayonet was misused, and also not to burst if accidentally fired whilst partially blocked. Barrels were proof fired then as now to ensure that they had a considerable reserve of strength. By the late 1850s, voices were being raised on behalf of steel rather than iron as the answer to problems of barrel strength. In the Whitworth rifle of 1863, steel barrels were tried out. This one was made out of Firth steel. Steel was generally adopted for rifles after the mid-1860s. Unfortunately, it was not so easy to provide equally durable cartridges at the same time. At the Royal Laboratory, a switch was made from making paper cartridges to ones of brass foil with paper gummed onto the brass. The whole cartridge was of the simplest rolled construction with an iron base riveted on. This frail cartridge was really Hobson's choice until about 1871. The means of extruding a solid brass case of military standard had not been devised. After 1871, when means were available to produce superior solid brass cartridges, the timing of their adoption became purely a financial matter. In contrast, the adoption of the sort of internal mechanics found in the Martini Henry, with its coil spring mechanism for detonating the cartridge, was very much a matter of convenience in production techniques. Greater accuracy of fire was another of the vital requirements of the time. At Enfield, trials were held to determine the shooting accuracy of various designs. This was an area where great contributions were made by private citizens. One man in particular contributed to the question of greater accuracy of fire. In his system, dominant in military small arms after 1870, the rifling consisted of very shallow grooves to minimize friction, with paper-patched bullets of hardened lead so formed that it was only after expansion by firing that they acquired the optimum ballistic shape. The inventor of this clever and successful system was William Ellis Metford. Metford possessed mastery of detail and vision, the concept of what the future would demand of firearms. Long before the Vickers arrived, Metford was the first man to worry about accuracy of fire in a machine gun, foreseeing that in arms development, success would eventually go to the most comprehensive weapon, coupled with an ability and capacity to manufacture it in quantity. From the time when the volunteers and their rifles first became a commonplace in early 19th century Britain, very many citizens had felt that they could contribute through arms to the security of their country. And that interest in arms development consequently led on to great advances in 19th century technology. Though nothing in the view of most of us can justify war, save a threat to our liberty, yet the general benefits arising out of a preoccupation with national defense flowed through the medium of technology into almost every aspect of Victorian life.